Hello, this is Zach Dennis with Cinematary, and this is film in Allegretto, or how the second movement in Beethoven's 7th Symphony is used in film. You've probably heard this song before. Most notably, it was used in the climactic scene of the 2010 Oscar Best Picture winner, The King's Speech, where King George VI, played by Colin Firth, gives his speech to the nation, signaling England's entry into World War II. The song provides thematic weight to the scene, which is a momentous point not only for the character, but also for the nation at large. Whenever the song is used in a film, it is generally used in this way, signaling a moment of great importance, either in the story or for a character. But before we look at that, let's first uncover the origin of the song and the intended purpose it had, according to Beethoven. The song was composed between 1811 and 1812 while Beethoven was spending time in the Bohemian spa town of Teplitz, while he waited for his health to improve after the composer suffered severe headaches and fever. He premiered the symphony in Vienna on December 8, 1813 and conducted the orchestra in its first ever playing. The concert was put on for charity in honor of the fallen and wounded soldiers at the Battle of Hanau during the War of the Sixth Coalition. When the second movement, titled Allegretto, premiered, the audience requested an encore. Describing Beethoven's conducting, violinist Louis Spohr said, "As a sforzando occurred, he tore his arms with a great vehemence asunder. At the entrance of a forte, he jumped in the air." Viennese audiences, miserable from Napoleon's 1805 and 1809 occupations of Vienna and hopefully awaiting a victory over him, embraced the symphony's energy and beauty. Richard Fried reported that the second movement was so notoriously popular throughout the following two decades that it sometimes was substituted for the slow movements of Beethoven's earlier symphonies. Belowitz rather disparagingly recalled that it was inserted into Symphony No. 2 in order to help pass off the remainder. In 1859, Ludwig Biscoff said, "The piece conjures up pictures of the autumnal merrymakings of the gleaners and wine dressers, the tender melancholy of lovelorn youth, the pious canticle of joy and gratitude for nature's gifts, and the final outburst when joy beckons again, and the dance melodies float out upon the air, and none stands idle." The movement is structured in a double variation form. It begins with the main melody, played by the violas and cellos, an ostinato of a quarter note, two eighth notes, and two quarter notes. This melody is then played by the second violins, while the violas and cellos play a second melody, described by George Grove as a string of beauties hand in hand. The first violins then take the first melody, while the second violins take the second. This progression culminates with the wind section playing the first melody while the first violin play the second. After this, the music changes from A minor to A major as the clarinets take a calmer melody to the background of light triplets played by the violins. This section ends 37 bars later with a quick descent of the strings on an A minor scale, and the first melody is resumed and elaborated upon in a strict fugato. Much like the Viennese audience, filmmakers and composers have found the energy and beauty of the piece to work in pivotal sequences in film. The earliest example is in director Edgar Ulmer's 1934 film, The Black Cat, which stars Boris Karloff and Bela Lugosi. In the film, Lugosi plays a psychiatrist visiting an old friend played by Karloff. While on his way to meet him, he runs into a honeymooning couple and strikes up a conversation, leading them to join in his visit. It is later revealed that Karloff's character is a Satan-worshipping priest, and when he challenges Lugosi on this claim, Beethoven's piece begins to play against it.
Come, Vitus.
The tug of Karloff compared to the humane duty of Lugosi's character is mimicked in the push and pull of Allegretto. Later, it was used to both open and close the 1961 film by French director Jacques Demy, Lola, in which a young dreamer runs into his former love and tries to strike up another fling. The titled woman, Lola, played by Anouk Aimée, is now a cabaret singer, and while she feels for the young man, played by Marc Miquel, she also still has feelings for her own lost love, Miquel, who is the figure seen during the opening credits. In this instance, the piece feels more like a precursor to what is to come in the film, which is filled with a typical melancholy tragedy one would expect from both Demy and his French New Wave counterparts. Another modern example was in the British romantic comedy by Melvin Frank titled A Touch of Class. The film starred George Segal and Glenda Jackson as two strangers who run into each other and decide to go away for a week to begin an affair. When they get to their destination, they grate on each other, culminating in an explosive fight. After cooling down, the two begin to accept one another and actually get on with the plan fleeing. This follows with them renting a London flat to use as their escape. Later in the film, Segal's character realizes he loves Jackson's character and rushes to the apartment to profess his feelings while at a concert of Beethoven with his wife. As he begins to lay down his emotions to Jackson, the second movement of the Seventh Symphony begins to play, echoing the growing realization by Jackson's character that this fling has become much more pronounced and real. And the facade they build on their trip, and with the flat, is over.
It's... Well, what I wanted to say was that, it's just that, I love you very much, and I can't seem to get you out of my mind. Which is not that important, but,
Oh my God.
More recently, the piece has been used in the Nicolas Cage vehicle Knowing, in the most recent X-Men movie, X-Men Apocalypse, when the titled villain, played by Oscar Isaac, uses his super mutant powers to release every nuclear missile in the world. In that scene, the Seventh Symphony works as a progressive rhythm to the slow-moving mayhem that Apocalypse is unleashing. But most influentially, the piece is used during the King's Speech. We looked at it before, but it is the essential scene for this piece of music. Up to this point in the film, most people have doubted the new king's ability to deliver a speech that will inspire the nation. Much like the people of Vienna in 1813, the English are broken down by the axe outside their walls and the threat of terror in their homes. Countering the looks of these solemn listeners, director Tom Hooper adds the progressive chords of the Seventh Symphony's melody in an attempt to bring similar pride and inspiration to the words of King George VI, as Beethoven did for the audience members that day in Vienna. The roll of the violas and cellos, along with the response of the wind section and clarinets, flows with the tension between words shown on Firth's face as his character struggles to get them out. The execution of the tones of the piece with the energy of the words and the melody are what creates the power of the sequence.
And reverently commit our cause to God. If one and all we keep resolutely faithful to it, then, with God's help, we shall prevail.
This will most likely not be the last time Beethoven's Seventh Symphony is used in film or television. There's just something about its restrained exuberance that inspires creative minds to attach it to their more monumental sequences. There's something inspiring about the piece. It begins so soft, slowly growing into a roar that goes away again and allows for a soft reflection. The roar returns before dying down again. Much like Beethoven's famed Pastoral Symphony, which the piece gets compared to most often, the composer crafts a piece that carries the highs and lows while giving each clarity and strength. During its time, it was used as a procession in an old cathedral or catacombs, a love dream of a sumptuous odalisque, a tale of Moorish knighthood, and to portray scenes from a masquerade. Maybe that's why filmmakers use it so often. It's perfect at portraying a range of emotions and has so many different inflections. And it does it in the most epic of fashions.